This is big things aguan. This is the bullet in Bob's arm. This is tenor sword singing. This is so rebel. This is bass with no treble. When I think of reggae music, I immediately think of bass. When you listen to reggae played loud on a big sound system, the low frequencies hit you in a certain way that you just don't seem to get from other music, especially in the time that reggae was just emerging. But the bass didn't always play as big a part. Before the slow bass-driven rocksteady groove that we now call reggae, there was ska. And before ska, there was mento. Mento is a fusion of African rhythms with some European elements that developed in Jamaica. It was played on instruments like banjo or guitar or fiddle, along with homemade instruments such as the rumba box. The rumba box is a large wooden box with a hole cut in the centre of one of the panels. Across that hole, there's metal strips, and those strips are tuned to different notes. By banging the box and plucking the metal strips, you can create drum beats and bass lines with a sound kind of like a double bass. Mento songs were often comical takes on everyday life or were based on work songs, often with a call and response. The most famous of which would have to be Deo, the banana boat song, made famous by Harry Belafonte in 1956. It was marketed as a calypso song by the American record label that released it, but it's actually based on the Jamaican folk song Daylight, as sung here in this 1954 recording by Miss Lou Bennett.
Come, Miss Atali, man, come tally me banana.
Data light, I'm your one.
Come fix your catamat if you can't take bunch banana.
Data light, I'm your one.
6 hand, 7 hand, 8 hand bunch.
Data light, I'm your one.
6 hand, 7 hand, 8 hand bunch.
Data light, I'm your one.
After Mento came ska in the late 1950s. Early ska bands had double bass playing walking bass lines, but the emphasis would be on the horns, keyboards and guitar, rather than the bass.
Jamaica's ska is the latest popular musical sound. The rhythm dominates the melody and consequently a driving beat provides an irresistible urge to dance.
That all changed again in the mid-1960s, when the groove slowed down.
The ska was very fast. You had to spin, you had to dance, you had to dance in a fast pace. So what we did was, at the time, most of them had the same bass line because the bass man didn't have enough time to emphasize on his bass line. So what we did was cut it down a little so the bass man could more move his fingers and have a line. So that's how you come to have these reggae lines. You know, you give him more time to do that. In the sky, you couldn't do that.
The bass now start more, you know, in charge. Well, to me, the bass is the instrument to me, who changed the identity of the music.
So the importance of bass in reggae music, you know, it's just like, I'm going to tell you, break it down to you very simple. Everyone knows what a car is, and you have to drive in a car. A car with 4 wheels, if you have 3 wheels on the car, it can't move. Simple terms is the same way with bass in reggae music, right? Now, if you just bass and drum can work along without keyboard, that's like a dub vibe. But without drum alone going on. Yeah, just maybe for a couple bars you'd have a drum alone going, but you need the bass line because them don't want the bass line for a roll, for a rap the music. You understand? And if you watch enough bass players most times, you see them have a hit movement or a thing of one for so you feel the music. So the bass is like very important in the foundation. When I started playing as a youth in the country, I'm in the country close to where Bob Marley was born. So we grew up in deep country where we have no light in the house, and you know we don't have FM radio, we have AM radio. AM radio means when it turns like 5-6 o'clock at night, when you start hearing different language. So in the days we just listen to some music, we hear Bob Marley. When I was growing up, a lot of music from Bob Marley time. And when I started music in the church, I was self-taught, and then it drove me to a place called Orchards in the hotels. But then I started to hear in bass, I started to focus on this man called Glenn Brownie. He don't play hard, you know, Glenn Brownie don't play, he play very light, but the bass sound heavy. And from he plays right now, Taurus Riley. He's one of the legend bass players that I look up to. And he's a family man. This guy that plays for Berries right now used to play with White River Reggae Bash. Long time festival, that guy named Trevor. He's played for Berries. Those are my idols in reggae bass. Yeah, man.
In modern music, the melody the vocal follows is known as the top line. I guess in reggae you could call it the bottom line, as quite often it's the bass that connects the vocal with the rest of the song. A perfect example of this is the dub poetry of Linton Kwesi Johnson.
I hear music in language, so that in a poem like, for example, Hit No Funny, I say them with tech chants, and that's what the bass plays. Da 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 da. And the horn section will play the same rhythm as well. You know, that was my aesthetic, that I wanted to write verse that sounded like a bass line. I wanted to write lines of poetry that sounded like a reggae bass line.
Bass and drums was the foundation of roots music. It was what people even used to identify a song. Even though the song was named something else, they would say, like, Fatty Fatty Bass Line, or the Book of Rules Bass Line. You know, because the line, the bass line, it was a driving force of the music.